Welcome everyone at today's second lecture. It is my great pleasure to introduce Professor Dariusz Buraczewski from the University of Wrocław. He's interested in random discrete structures such as random walks in random environment, branching random walks, branching processes, EARN models, and stochastic recursions. He has already written 45 papers and a book on this subject. His field of research is full of interesting results and surprising results, which connects mathematics to theoretical computer science and statistical physics. He obtained his PhD in 2002 in harmonic analysis under the supervision of Professor Eva Damek. 8 years later, he got his habilitation for his research in probability. And finally, in 2014, he got the scientific title of professor. So I think that we can start. The floor is yours.
Thank you. Let me thank Sabrinik for the invitation and for the opportunity to talk here. It's a great pleasure to meet with you in slightly different environment. I'm in Bydgoszcz, not in Wrocław. And of course, it's a great pleasure after the pandemic just to see you in person, not via Zoom. And the title is Random Walks in Random Environment. This is the model I have been working on for last 3 or 4 years, and we are still trying to understand this model jointly with Ala, somewhere here. Oh, I see Ala, and with Piotr Dyszewski. And the idea is that I will try to give very elementary talk to explain you what is the model and why this model is interesting. And I will try to keep the talk at the very elementary level. So if you have just some questions, something will be unclear, then please stop me. Please ask questions. Please not hesitate to ask. So let us start with. From the very beginning, I mean, at some point of my talk, I will just try to remind you some fundamental facts from probability theory that you all should know. But I think it's always worthy to recall some fundamental facts. So some motivation: why people consider random walks? I mean, why random walks are really important? And there are many reasons, but I think the main reason is that because random walks is because people are interested in Brownian motion, and random walks is let's say discrete version of Brownian motion. If people want to understand this Brownian motion, then sometimes it's easier to understand discrete world. I mean to formulate the same questions but in discrete world, and to see to use slightly different tools. And just to give a very short story of the Brownian motion, I know that you all know this, but just to recall you some fundamental facts. So people are interested in the movement of gas molecules. So we can think about one very particular molecule, gas molecule, and we want to follow its trajectory. We want to see what is the trajectory of a gas molecule in the air. And we all know that there are many gas molecules, and the one particular molecule hits very often with other molecules. And after every time it starts get new work, in after each hitting, it starts to move in some random direction. So this causes that the movement of one particular gas molecule is very irregular, very chaotic, and this is, let's say, two-dimensional graph. And just to give some history, I mean, the Brownian motion, the name of the Brownian motion is of honor Robert Brown, who described behavior of pollen of some plants which moves in the water, and he just observed this plants under a microscope. It's clear that he was not the first who observed this irregular motion, but anyway, he was somehow it seems he was one of the first person who described this this behavior of these molecules. And then, let's say, at the beginning of the 20th century, Smoluchowski and Einstein. Here are these two photos of Smoluchowski and Einstein. I hope you recognize both of them. The photo of Einstein is not typical. I mean, probably you know Einstein with a lot of hairs at the head, but I choose this photo because this photo was done exactly at the time 94-95. So they modeled the Brownian motion. I mean, they describe independently the model of Brownian motion, of the motion of the one particular gas molecule. And of course, there is a very long story when mathematicians started to work on the Brownian motion. You know all of this perfectly from your cars, from your gravity cars. The other motivation to study Brownian motion is just that, I mean, there are many examples in the real world which say that we should consider such object like a Brownian motion. So the other example is just stock market. When you observe the random indices, this is just I think one of the most important indices, S&P 500 index. It's related to the New York stock for the last 20 years. You again observe some very irregular curve with which seems very very chaotic. And okay, all these examples led to let's say to mathematical model, the model of the Brownian motion, and the definition. I will not recall the all the details, but you know that Brownian motion is just a continuous process which has independent and stationary increment. In terms of the gas molecule, this independent and stationary increment essentially says that the environment in which the molecules moves is the same at the same place and at the same time, which somehow the environment is homogeneous. And so we know Brownian motion has many beautiful properties. And one of the way to study Brownian motion, to understand what are properties of the Brownian motion, is to look at simpler model, which are just random walks. And to define random walks, what are the random walks? I will just need random walks on the integers, I mean on the one-dimensional lattice. And I will consider only simple random walk. Simple means that this is the walk which jumps only to the neighbor, which means you can imagine we have just the set of integers. We have one, I don't know, particle, molecule, walker, which is placed at zero. And we have some given probability P, which could be 1/2, it could be some any number between 0 and 1. And now the walker decides if he goes to -1 or to +1 according to his probability, which means he has a coin with the head probability P, and if there is a head, then it goes to 1, if not to -1. And the same happens at point 1. I mean, you have the same probability P, and the procedure just repeats. And this is just the model of mathematical model of simple random walk on integers. And of course, we need to now to write everything in mathematical language. So we xn is just the position after n steps, and it's clear that this process satisfies. Do you see the? This process satisfies the Karsky's relation that xn plus 1 is xn plus or minus 1 if probability p and 1 minus p. And in the end, xn can be written as sum of independent, identically distributed random variables. So there are iid and probability that y is 1 is p, that y is minus 1 is 1 minus p. Yeah, so, and this is the model that I hope we perfectly understand. And of course, if you have simply random walk, if we have any random walk, we have there are out of questions we want to answer. And here are some of the questions. Yes, the first question is about the recurrence and transience. So the I think the simpler question is, assume the process starts from zero, what is the probability that the process after some time will return to zero again? So this is, if the probability is one, then we say that the process is recurrent, and this means that indeed the process will visit all the points on the line infinitely many times. Otherwise, if the probability is smaller than one, then the process is called transient and it just goes to plus or minus infinity. And of course, there are other questions. Yes, the question is, what is the rate of convergence? I mean, if p is greater than 1/2, so what is the rate of convergence to plus infinity? And this is just, you know, the answer. This is just the law of large numbers, yes, which says that we need to compute expectation of y, and we know that essentially xn behaves like n times expectation of y. This is just law of large numbers, strong or weak. And the next question, what is the typical distance of the process from the mean? Or if p is just 1/2 and the mean is zero, so what is the typical distance of the process from zero? And this is a central limit theorem that we also know. So if you ask some questions about simple random walk or also other random walks on integers, then essentially we have a lot of questions, and we know most of the answers for all these questions. But the problem is slightly, and of course, random walk can be defined on more general structures, yes, on graphs. In particular, the Brownian motion is not the only motivation to consider random walk. There are many other examples, for example, from computer science, saying that we should consider random walks. It's an elementary object, and we should understand the behavior. But the question is, if this model is the right one, I mean, it is really the model would describe reality. And so maybe I remind that we were saying about the movement of one particle, of one, let's say, gas molecule in the air, and to assume that everything is perfect. I mean, that the environment doesn't change in the time, the environment doesn't change in the place, which means that somehow the gas molecule moves in some perfect world. And the world usually is not perfect. I mean, there are some kind of obstacles, defects, porosity, fluctuation. The environment is not usually perfect in the sense that it's not homogeneous. So one should find some different model which describe the motion of particles in environment which is not homogeneous, but it has some inhomogeneity. And of course, there are many models, yes, which try to answer this question. And I want to talk about one very particular model, random walk in random environment. This was the model introduced in the 70s by Solomon, who was the student of Kesten, and in a paper by Kesten, Kozlov, and Spitzer. All these names are, I mean, Kesten, Spitzer, are very important names for probability. What is the model? Again, we start at zero. Yes, we have some walker or particle placed at zero, and now we want to consider its consecutive steps. And now we assume that we are given at zero, we are given some random weight p naught. And now p naught is not the number, but it's just some random variable, which means that in the previous case, for the simple random walk, we just fix some number p, and we are saying that at every point we move with probability p to the right or to the left. Now we say that the first step, we choose the environment, which means that with every point on the line or with every integer, we associate some random variable, p naught, p1, p2, there are random variables. Next, we fix these random variables, and we consider random walk according to this weight. So starting at zero, we have probability p naught of passing to one, or one minus p naught to minus one. So then the particle moves to one, and at one we have some different random weight, which is p1, and this is the probability of passing from one to two, or from one to to zero. So essentially, we have just to describe in detail these models. So we start with the environment. We start with omega, which is just the sequence of dependent, identically distributed random variables tk. So there are all the random numbers from interval 0, 1. And now to define this random walk, random environment, we just say that the probability of passing from k to k plus 1 is pk. And probability of passing from k to k minus 1 is 1 minus pk. So this omega here is to underline that we are in random environment, is that this probability depends on some random sequence.
Sorry, so I have a question. So if we are at 1 and then we come back to 0 again, so the probability is still the same p0, yes? Which, yes. Okay, it was random, but it is for the whole process is once it's chosen is a fixed random variable, yes?
Yes, that's true, that we just fix environment, which and with every point we associate some random weights. And every time we visit, let's say, 2, we use p2, which is random, but the first step is to choose the weight. And the next step, having this weight, we consider the random walk. Okay. Is the model clear, or do you have some other questions? Okay, and now what to do next? So this p omega is called quench probability, and we can consider two kinds of randomness. I mean, maybe I will show everything. So we can consider two kinds of randomness. I mean, the first one is that we choose this random weights, and we observe the random walk, knowing what are the weights, what are p1, p0, p1, p2, and so on. And this is called quenched probability, and this random process with respect to this quenched probability p omega is just classical Markov chain. But there is also other way of observing the process. I mean, we can just do the same, which means that we do the first step, which means that choose weight. The weights are associated with integers, but we observe only the walker. We don't know what are the weights. We know that there's a process that there are random weights. There is random process, but now we observe only the process. We don't know what are really the weights, what are p0. We don't know the values. We can know the law, but not the values. In the sense that, and this probability is called annealed probability, in the sense that we just average all this environment. And one crucial difference of these two models is that if we don't see the weights, the process is not a Markov chain. It's not Markov chain because somehow when the particle moves, it starts to learn what are the weights, what are the probabilities. I mean, if you know, for example, that we visited, let's say, the point 2 many times, and usually from 2 we pass to 1, then we expect that the probability p2 is rather smaller than 1/2, that we have some drift to the left, yes, which means that somehow the particles start to learn the probability, and after some time it can predict what are the values of the weights. So this is the reason that this is not Markov chain. And what I want to talk about is the second model. So we start with random weights. We fix the weights, but we don't see them, and we just observe the motion of the particle.
So sorry. In other words, we would like to reconstruct the measure on the space of all these sequences pk. Yes, this is this B space. Yes. Somehow the measure on B, we would like to reconstruct it by observing the process. Yes, is that right?
No, we don't want to reconstruct this measure. We just want to. Okay, the starting point is that we know what is the law of this the starting point to what are given data is that the law of P. So we can say that we are given like a problem given. Maybe it's not given the law of P. Of PK, we want to understand XN.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you.
So, we know what is the law of P, but we don't see the concrete realization of P. And we just observe the walker, the particle, and we won't describe what is behavior of it.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you.
Some other questions? Or?
So now these like two separate aspects. So these probabilities in each node and these random variables x, they're not independent, right? This is because I thought we have like these two axes, like
they're not independent. Yes, I agree. I mean,
okay, so it's not that we do two experiments. Like first we choose the probabilities and then we walk. It's like merged.
No,
together.
We choose the weights. I mean, we have the law of P, so we choose the weights. We have some realization of the weights. Then we just froze this weight. We there are somewhere attached to each integer, but we don't see the weight. We don't know exactly what are the values. We don't know what is the realization. We just know the procedure to produce the weight, which we have some black box which produce the weight pk. So for every integers we produce the weight, but we don't see the values. And what we can observe is only the process, the random walk.
Okay, my question was more about what is the general space, probability space that we deal with?
So
is it a product space?
Product.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and now Just to state some properties, I will not prove the first one. We will not go into this, but it turns out that there's quite nice criterion of recurrence in this random environment, and to describe recurrence, we need to look at these values 1 minus p over p. Which means that in the end we have a sequence here. So this row denotes, let's say, the typical. So we have rho k, which is one minus pk over pk. And if the expectation of logarithm rho is zero, then the process is recurrent, which means that it just oscillates from minus infinity to plus infinity and visit every point infinity many times. And if the logarithm of rho is smaller than zero, then it's n goes to plus infinity. And why smaller than zero? So essentially, if logarithm of rho is expectation is smaller than zero, this means that logarithm rho is usually smaller than zero, which means that if you look at this formula, which means that usually this means that usually p is greater than 1/2. So we have some drift to plus infinity, but the difference with the classical case is that we don't look at the expectation of p, but look at the expectation of logarithm of rho. So this is just some small observation. But let us try to observe. I'm trying to clean. Okay, let us look at how to understand this random walk. So let us just simulate this random walks. Let us use computer and try to see what are trajectories of this random walk. So if you have simple random walk and p is greater than 1/2, then what we expect is that this random walk goes to plus infinity at linear with linear speed. So there is some constant velocity, and the particle just goes to plus infinity, of course, with some kind of small deviations. So this is the typical trajectory for the first model, for simple random walk. For the second model, so we assume that we are in this transient case, which is this assumption, which goes to plus infinity. And to avoid some trivial case, we assume that rho is sometimes greater than one, which means that P is sometimes this assumption here says that sometimes P is smaller than 1/2, which means that there are some points on the line where the drift is push us to minus infinity, to zero. Yeah, so this is just to avoid some trivial cases. And now when you observe the trajectory, we see that essentially the trajectory goes to plus infinity, but as you can observe the trajectory, there are many places where the trajectory is indeed almost constant. You see that there are places where the trajectory, there are some places which are difficult to pass, that there are some kind of obstacles. And now we want to understand exactly what kind of obstacles, I mean, what is the reason why the trajectory cannot pass this point? I mean, why the trajectory spent here a lot of time? And secondly, we want to understand properties of this random walk. Yes, I mean, from this picture, it's even not clear whether this random walk goes linearly fast to plus infinity. I mean, what is the law of large numbers? What are limit theorems? Yes, what are some other properties? And so the point is that somehow we need to measure the force that which push the walker to plus infinity. Yes, and to measure this force, so one considers some kind of, this is called potential function. Namely, one considers the sum of logarithms of rho k. And I will show you the next picture just to explain what happens here. So this is the graph of the potential. And in the case of the simple random walk of this graph, we can imagine that we just want to walk, we just travel, and we have some force which push us to the right. It's usually when you are in the mountains, we usually prefer, if you go randomly, we usually prefer, finally we prefer this going down and up. And this is essentially what happens here, that we have some force which push us to go to the right, to plus infinity. What happens in this case of random walks in random environment, is that since the probability that rho is greater than one, I will recall you that this means that this probability that with positive probability p is smaller than 1/2, there are many places where the weights are smaller than 1/2, which means there are many places, many integers which push us to the left, not to the right. And this is visible on this picture. You see that here, the very beginning, there's some force which push up to plus infinity, to the right, which means that these p's are usually greater than 1/2. We want to go to the right. But then there is some kind of small mountains and we need to climb. It's difficult to climb. We usually, this is exactly the place where the weights are smaller than 1/2. So we can think that what happens here, is that we have some weights which push to the right, but on the other side we have some weights which are smaller than 1/2. So we are in the valley and we spend here a lot of time. This caused some delay. This caused that the speed of the walker is much lower than we should expect. And you see that the same happens here, that there is some valley and we need, in fact, first we are we spent a lot of time at the bottom of the valley. We want to climb here or here. After some time using Borel-Cantelli lemma, we know that finally we will reach the top and we just continue the excursion. So you see that what happens here, it is exactly existence of such a valley, existence of such points, which you are in the middle of these two arrows. Yes, we are in the middle of this area where it's a drift to plus infinity and to minus infinity, and we need to we have some obstacles and we need to go right. Okay. So this is the reason that the particle moves much slower than usually. And here's some there are some results concerning simple random walk and random walk in random infinity. And I just would like to show you the differences between these two models. So on one side, you assume we have simple random walk with constant p. On the other hand, we have random pk's, which are iid. We assume we have drift to plus infinity, and we assume that that sometimes we have this negative drift, this force which to minus infinity. Okay, so first of all, we know what is the law of large numbers. It's just the typical law of large numbers from the probability cars. And we have very similar law of large numbers here, but it turns out that sometimes the speed can be just zero. So there are some cases, I will not explain exactly this moment. I will, in a few minutes, I will say when the speed is zero. And you see that it can happen that that the speed of this particle is sublinear. It's not linear, but it's slower. And the reason is are exactly these values. And so now we know what is the central limit theorem. Yeah? This is just the classical central theorem, which says that the typical distance from the mean is of the square root, and the difference essentially converges weakly to the normal law. And here's happened something strange in the sense that we consider the distance from the mean, but it seems that the distance, it's not, sometimes it's square root of n, as in this case, but sometimes it's of different times. Sometimes it's n to power alpha, when alpha is smaller than 2, or n to power 1 over alpha. So it's of completely different order. And I will explain in a moment exactly what are the cases. And also we don't obtain here the normal law, but to some other law which is related to stable laws. So we see that the behavior is completely different. Some of you may know what are large deviations. So essentially, this is the probability that the distance of the mean from the expectation is greater than some epsilon. And we know that this probability for simple random walks decreases exponentially fast. This is this is quite well known. I'm sure that some of you know this result. For random walk in random environment, the situation is different. I mean, this we know that this probability is polynomially slow, not exponentially small. So we see that the behavior is different. Okay, and the last example is there is a theorem by Erdos and Dvoretsky. The theorem says that if we put three particles at zero and they will move independently according to the rules of the simple random walk, then they will meet infinitely often with probability one. So again, we start with three particles placed at zero. This particle moves independently. And the theorem says that they all will meet again at some point infinitely often with probability one. But the same theorem says that if we put four particles at zero, then they will meet at the same point only finitely many times with probability one. So three is the critical value. Three, four is the critical value. For random walk in random environment, there is a result saying that we can put arbitrary many walkers at zero, but finitely many. Arbitrary means that we are, let's say, 10 or 20. And they will meet infinitely often in probability one. The reason is we know where they will meet. I mean, they will meet exactly at the bottom of the valley. It seems that there are very deep valleys which are very difficult to leave, and one can even point these valleys and it turns out that they will meet exactly at the bottom of the valley infinitely often.
Sorry, once again, this walkers start the excursion in the same point, yes?
At zero.
At zero, okay, all of them. Okay, thank you.
Okay, and what is What I would like to talk to you about is I would like to show you essentially what kind of methods are beyond this random access. I assume you know some, you know some probability, and I would like to show you what kind of techniques can be used to prove this central limit theorem, just to see what kind of mathematics is behind. And of course, I'm not able to present you proof with all the details, but I think that at least the idea will be clear. So,
just to make sure from the previous slide, so we defined these rho variables, right? We had rho k, and the whole rho is what the product variable of all of them.
Okay. Rho k is defined in this way, which means that and I just denote by rho n of them. Important is only the law, yeah? Not.
I just want to have the intuition. What does it mean that the probability that rho is greater than one is positive? So it means that.
Which means that the probability that p is smaller than 1/2. Positive. Okay, the point is that I want to avoid the situation when all the weights push up to the right. So this is somehow a trivial situation which should be comparable with simple random walk. I really want to have some weights which push us to the other direction. And to be sure that I have these weights, I need this hypothesis.
Okay, so on one axis, on z axis, when we move. When our walk is only on the axis, it just means that there can be finitely many such points that push us left.
By Borel-Cantelli lemma, they must be infinitely many.
Okay, so axes.
Moreover, the Borel-Cantelli lemma says that there can be arbitrary long interval in which all the weights point to the left. Yes.
Okay, so it tells us that those valleys appear.
Yes, and they are deeper and deeper.
Okay, thank you.
It's like with the coin. Yes, we know that if we toss the coin arbitrarily long, then we can get arbitrarily long distance of heads. Yes, it's a Borel-Cantelli dilemma. This is the same happens here. That we know that the valleys are deeper and deeper there. Okay, just to remind you, yes, this central limit theorem you all know. It, you know by heart the proof of this theorem, I'm sure. And what you should also know, but maybe not remember, is limit theorems related to stable laws. Yes, and I don't want to state in full generality what are the other limit theorems. But just for a very particular case, if you have a sequence of IID random variables which are non-negative, and these random variables behave regularly at infinity, which means that they have regularly varying tails, which is exactly stated here, for some alpha smaller than one, then we know that the sum minus the mean v can be zero or expectation. If the expectation is zero, if the expectation does not exist, which means alpha is between zero and one, then V is zero. If alpha is between one and two, then V is just the expectation. If alpha is equal to one, let us skip this case for this talk. Then the correct normalization is N to one over alpha. And the limit is some stable law. I will not define now what's a stable law. We can think that there is some limit, and this is what we need. And the theorem by Kester and Kozlowski, I would like to talk about, says that if the random walk is transient, and now we have slightly different assumptions, and maybe I will explain exactly what happens here. On the previous slide, I assumed that the probability that that rho is greater than one is positive. So we can consider the function, the transform of this random variables rho, which is e to power rho s. Yes, and we denote this function by pi of s. And now, what is derivative of this function? Yes, you can compute just the derivative. The derivative of this function is expectation rho of s logarithm rho. In particular, the derivative of this function at zero is just the expectation of logarithm rho, and by our assumption is negative, which means that in our case, when the random walk is transient, the derivative at zero is zero. What can be proved is that the function phi is convex. This is not difficult. This is just Hölder inequality, nothing more. And working under these assumptions, observe that this function phi must diverges to plus infinity when s goes to plus infinity. Yes, we know that pi of s goes to plus infinity when s goes to plus infinity. It's because this rho to power s on a set of positive measure must increase to plus infinity. So we have convex functions which goes to plus infinity and starts at one. Yes, phi of s at zero is just one. So what is the graph of this function? The graph of this function is that it starts at one, the derivative is negative, and it must go to infinity. So this theorem says that the crucial parameter is this alpha. This alpha, which is the intersection point with the line one. Yes, and if you know this alpha, then indeed we can describe all the properties of this random walk. In particular, if alpha is, it turns out that if alpha is smaller than one, then the velocity is sublinear. If alpha is greater than one, then the speed of the particle is linear. We have the law of large numbers. And now I don't want to explain all the symbols here because we don't have a lot of time, but essentially the theorem says that we know how to normalize the random walk to obtain some non-trivial limit. This converges in distribution. So we need to restrict the mean if the mean exists. If the mean does not exist, v is just zero, and divide by some number. And this sequence an, it's okay. It could be square root of n if alpha is greater than two, for alpha between one and two is just n to one over alpha. For alpha between zero and one is n to alpha. So there are many different cases, but I don't want to explain you now what are the cases and why. I want to show you what is behind this model. What is the proof? It's more interesting. I'm looking at writing all these possible cases. Okay, so the point is I want to say a few words about the proof. So once again, we know what is rho. This is the theorem we want to prove. Okay, and the first observation is that instead of looking at the process, at the random walk, we look at the heating times. So Tn is the first time when the particle reach point n. And essentially, these two random variables, these two processes xn and tau n, there are in sense tn is somehow generalized inverse of xn. I mean, you can think that if xn is very slow, then the value of tn is very large. And the general idea is that if you can describe one of these sequences, you can describe the second one. I mean, if you know what behavior of tn, we essentially know what is behavior of xn. We just need to reverse the function. So the general idea is that we need to prove limit theorems for Tn. We need to prove this kind of limit theorems for Tn. And this alpha, this one is one of these stable laws, which is the limit in the central limit theorem. Okay, and so let us try to understand what is Tn. Again, this is the first time when the particle hits n. So we start at zero, we have somewhere n, and we want to calculate how much time the particle needs to hit n. Okay, so let us write, okay, by definition, yeah, this is Tn is just the number of steps in this period, and we divide these steps into the steps the particles move to the right and to the left. Yes, and again, if we start at zero, want to finish at n, we calculate how many of the particles move, how many times the particle move to the left and how many times to the right. And since we start at zero and finish at n, we can compare this value. Yeah, we know that the number of steps to the right should be the number of steps to the left plus n. And so this is the next slide, is that essentially we need only to calculate the steps to the left. And okay, I will denote this number by un. And what essentially we did, we just reduce the problem of the limit theorems to the limit theorems for un. Okay, I have forgotten to say that our aim is to reduce everything to this theorem that was on the previous slide. But essentially, you want to reduce everything to this red stable loss, to this theorem for IID random variables. So let us. So again, we have random process. Start at zero, it hits n, and we want to calculate the number of steps to the left. And it turns out that there is some special structure hidden behind this process. And now we want to understand what is the structure. So let us start the process. Yes, you have particle which is placed at zero. And again, we calculate the numbers to the left and want to find some additional structure. So every time when the particle moves to the left, we just draw an arrow, right? We just draw an edge, we construct some graph. So we moved from zero to minus one, so we draw the edge. Now we return from minus one to zero, so we don't draw a new edge, but we just use this edge to return to zero. Okay, and what happens next? We move from zero to minus one, so we draw edge. Next, we move from minus one to minus two. So we again draw edge. And now we return to minus one. So we just use this one edge. We again go from minus one to minus two. So we add new edge. And you see that repeating this procedure, we turn to minus one, we return to zero. And now we jump from zero to one, but we want to calculate only the steps to the left. So we don't calculate this jump, but we just denote that we have a jump and start new tree. And we see that after some times, we obtain such forest. Yes, it's some random trees, some forest. Okay, and we reach two. So, and now we can calculate, if you know how many are, if you calculate these red edges, you can calculate the number of steps from zero to one. Yeah, this is something like, I don't know, 15 or maybe more. Okay, and we want to understand the structure of this random object. If you have some forest, we want to understand what is this object, what mathematically is this object. And so let us look at this part and try to think a little why we're at this point. We are here at one, and why there are two edges going from the to the left. I mean, why there are exactly two edges going to the left? So what was the situation in terms of the random walk? So in terms of the random walks, we are at one, and now we need to choose either we go to the left or to the right. The probability is remind you is P1. So the first decision was we go to the left. After some time, we return again to one. So the first decision, we go to the left and this is this edge. After some time, we return again to one. And again, we need to take decision. We go to the left or to the right. So we decided to go to the left. After some time, we return to one, and then we just jump here. So what is the law of the of this number of these edges? You know, do you see what is the law? So the number of the edges is the we wait for the first success, which is going to the right. So the law which is here is just the geometrical law, parameter P1. This is what something that we understand perfectly. The same happens in other places, yes? And now when we look at this process has some names, this branching process, yes? You all know what branching process. This branching process is in random environment in the sense that the environment is random. At every time we use different parameters, yes? At every time these two have different parameters. With one immigrant, yes, because in the end, okay, we should rotate this picture and start from the top to bottom, yes, and start this procedure. So we see that we can start here with, let's say, with one immigrant, produce the process. At point one, we have one immigrant, the next immigrant, and so on. So essentially, what we need to do is we want to calculate the population of this process. Yes, with a branching process, we want to calculate the population. So again, this is the similar picture. And so now I reverse the time, yes, to calculate the process from the from the beginning and going down. So this is, let's say, summarization of this process. The name of this process again is branching process in random environment with one immigrant. And the formal definition is given here in these lines. Yes, we start with zero particles. We do not count this immigrant. And now how many particles are at, if you know how many particles are at generation k minus one, so all these particles and the immigrant produce random numbers of kids. Yes, and then random number of kids is either noted by vjk, and these vjks, they are independent, conditional independent, given the environment they're independent, and they have geometrical log parameter pk. Okay, is the model clear or have some questions? Because now we can forget about the random walk. We can forget about everything I was talking up to now, and now we just have new model, new process, and we want to prove limit theorems for this process. It's the motivations for random walks, but this is exactly what we want to prove now. Okay, and I will just I will not give you the proof, but what I would like to show is that it turns out that this process dies out quite often. We have some independent parts. This can be proved that it turns out that this process leaves very short, in the sense that if you denote by T1 the first extinction time, one can prove that T1 is finite random variables, even T1 even has exponential moment, which means that we start the process with one immigrant. The process after some time just extinct, and we start new process, new independent copy of this process, and again and again. Okay, I denote by W1 the population before the first extinction time, so this means that this is W1. I denote the number of population here by W2, and okay, this is clear. Pk is the k extinction time. And now, if you want to prove limit theorems for the total population up to time n, it's essentially comparable with this population before the extinction time. But these random variables are independent. So essentially, what we need to understand what are the tails of these random variables w1 and so on. And it turns out that one can quite efficiently estimate this random variable WK. And there is one more process, which is one more model, which is hidden behind all these things. Namely, let us compute the quench expectation. Yes, we have, again, this is the model, we have two types of randomness. First, we choose the environment, this way it's decay, and then we start the branching, we start the population. So let us somehow try to simplify the model and just compute the quench expectation. And this is very easy calculation. Namely, if we compute the quench expectation of Zn, then using this formula, what is this? The expectation of Vk, Vj is just rho k, or in these settings, rho n. So we need to compute the quench expectation of Zn and add the immigrant. So you see that these new random variables Rn satisfy some stochastic recursion. And it turns out that this model is, I think, the simplest model one can study. And there are many properties of these models which are known. I don't have time to talk about this model. This is a different model, and it still requires some time to describe it. But it turns out the conclusion is that if you know what is the stationary measure of this new model, if you know the stationary measure of this new model, which means that we know that there's some random variables, we just solve solution to this equation, then the tails are comparable. And they both behave like T2 minus alpha, where alpha is exactly the parameter I explained to you on previous slide. And now we are exactly in the settings of this central limit theorem for IID random variables, yes, without second moment. So if alpha is smaller than one, than two, then we know that the behavior of Zn is comparable with behavior of this process, and this essentially converges to some stable law. So just to summarize this discussion, we start with random walk in random environment. We formulate the problem of limit theorems in terms of this branching process in random environment. And finally, we reduce everything just to this random recursion. This is just to explain what happens behind. Okay, so I still have 1 minute. So I just want to mention that what we are doing now is to want to understand exactly what is the role of this random environment. I mean, what is the influence of this random environment for the walk, and to want to consider some model that is between this simple random walk and random walking random environment. And the model is as follows. I mean, we put the weights not at every point, but we choose randomly some points on the line. We put the random weights only at this point. And in all the remaining points, we just put the weight 1/2. Okay, and so we want to understand now somehow to play with the parameters, with the distance between these distinguished points, and to understand what is the real role of the random environment for the process. And for example, one can prove under some assumptions, we don't need to read the details now, that sometimes the process behaves like square root of n, but the limit is not normal, but some very complicated process. I will not describe it. Now, together with Ala and Piotr Gryszewski, we want to understand some quench limit theorems, large deviations, and so on. Okay, and just some final comments is that I was thinking about, I started with Brownian motion. Finally, I talk about random walks. And of course, you should ask, okay, but what happens with Brownian motion in random environment? So this is completely different story, different method, but tomorrow there will be a talk of Professor Bobrovsky, and he will talk about skew Brownian motion. So this is the Brownian motion when the environment is perturbed only at zero, at one point. So essentially this is Brownian motion, but something happens at zero. So tomorrow during this talk, you will see what happens, what kind of tools are used to to study continuous processes with slight perturbation of the environment. Okay, so thank you for attention.
Thank you for the talk. Are there any questions?
Okay, so I would like to ask whether I understood this last model, correctly. So we choose some point in which there will be some obstacles, and we choose them according to what measure?
Okay, there is no, okay, this is open. I mean, what I'm saying is that we choose some random points, is this blue dot. We don't say exactly what is the distance. I mean, depending if the distance between these points is small, the sense, let's say if the mean is finite, if the mean of C is finite, then the properties of these models are essentially comparable with the previous model. But what is really interesting is the situation which we consider here. If the distance doesn't have finite moment, but some regularly varying but has only very small moment, then really some new phenomena appears. And I want to say that we, depending on the assumptions on the distance between two distinguished points, one can get different results. And the most interesting situation is when the points are really rare.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and maybe one more question. So if we, see our this Brownian motion, one can view this Brownian motion as a scaling limit of the random walk, yes, and then it turns out that this is still a function, but okay, it is not differentiable at any point, but even the very fact that this is the function is itself non-trivial. For example, in already in the two dimensions you have this Gaussian free fields, where a typical instance of the Gaussian free field is not a function anymore, but a general function. So my question is whether one could expect that also, for example, in this random environment case, you could maybe get with probability, non-zero probability, something which is not a function anymore, but a generalized function.
Okay,
is it possible?
I'm not able to answer this question. I mean, we never studied some scale limit of this kind of processes.
Okay, but still, what is your feeling about it? Do you expect that it would be still a function, or it would be more regular than the ordinary random ordinary Brownian motion, or maybe less regular?
I'm not able. I don't know.
Okay. Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Are there any other questions?
So this model with chosen blue dots is to somehow model some particular situations where in most or many points we know what happens, right? There is a fixed probability, but we know that there will be some points when we are not sure what will happen. Okay.
You can, for example, imagine you have just Brownian motion in RD, which moving Brownian motion, you have some kind of some membranes which are placed randomly, some which would somehow disturb, somehow change the properties when the Brownian motion hits this membrane. So this is in this case you can somehow try to study similar models in this continuous settings.
So are there any observations that indicate that this sparse model is better to represent these, for example, gas processes than just the Brownian motion, or?
Oh no, what I'm saying is that for this discrete model with this sparse environment, it's quite natural to define, let's say, continuous model of this Brownian motion with some kind of obstacles placed RDS, but I'm not saying that this is more natural. There is some motivation behind this model in this paper I mentioned here, but I'm not claiming that it's more natural than the other model.
Okay, thank you.
Just for the sake of curiosity, what happens here?
Okay, anyone else? If no, are there any questions on Zoom?
I don't see any questions.
Okay. How do you go on, please? Okay, so we can thank once more for